Assalamu alaikum. I'd like to talk about how to assess the risk of bias of randomized controlled trials and to judge a certain trial to have low risk of bias, high risk of bias, or unclear risk of bias. So in order to do critical appraisal for a certain RCT, you have to answer three important questions. The first question is, how much the risk of bias is. This question addresses an important aspect of the critical appraisal for RCTs, which is the validity of the RCT. In other words, what is the quality of the RCT? Is this a well-designed and well-conducted RCT? And is this a reliable RCT that I can trust its results or not? The second question is, what are the results of the RCT? This question addresses the representativeness of the results. In other words, how big the sample size is, how well do the participants in the trial represent the general population, and how large and how precise was the treatment effect. The third question is, how can I apply the results of the trial to my patient's care? And this question assesses the applicability of the RCT. In other words, are the participants in the trial similar to the patients I'm treating? Are the outcomes measured by the study important to my population? And whether the intervention proposed by the trial is cost-effective and provide greater value than the intervention I'm currently using. The focus of my presentation will be on the first question, which is concerned about the risk of bias assessment for a certain RCT. So in order to assess the risk of bias for a certain RCT, we use the Cochrane risk of bias assessment tool. The tool was established in 2008 and updated in 2011, and it's the most commonly used tool to assess the risk of bias nowadays, especially for those who are working on systematic reviews and would like to assess the risk of bias of their included RCTs. The tool consists of seven domains that assess the bias that could arise from the randomization process, allocation concealment, blinding of the study participants and the treating physicians, blinding of the outcome assessors, incomplete outcome data, selective reporting, and other sources of bias. All these concepts will be explained in details in the upcoming slide. In 2017, the Cochrane collaboration revised the old tool and established a revised one, which is called the revised Cochrane risk of bias assessment tool, which was further updated in 2019. The tool is relatively new and less commonly used compared to the old one, but it's more reliable and recommended by the Cochrane collaboration for risk of bias of RCTs. The new tool consists of six domains that assess the risk of bias that could arise from the randomization process, deviations from the intended intervention, missing outcome data, measurement of the outcome, selection of the reported results, and the overall risk of bias. I'm not going to mention all the differences between the new tool and the old one, as this is not the aim of this video, but the aim of this video is to explain the new tool, or the revised Cochrane risk of bias assessment tool, and to highlight some of the important differences between the new tool and the old tool. In order to facilitate the risk of bias assessment process and make it easier to understand, I'm going to do risk of bias assessment for this RCT and use it as a real scenario to illustrate all the concepts I'm going to explain in the upcoming slides. So the title of this study is Education increases disposal of unused opioids after total joint arthroplasty, a cluster randomized controlled trial. So the research question of this trial was whether pre-operative opioid-specific patient education confers a reduction in average opioid consumption, number of opioid refills, number of patients with opioid leftover pills post-operatively, and number of patients taking opioid after hospital discharge compared to the treatment as usual or the standard of care for adult individuals undergoing total joint arthroplasty, either total hip replacement or total knee replacement. The first domain of the new tool is concerned about assessing the risk of bias arising from the randomization process, also known as selection bias. So in this domain, you have to answer three questions by yes, probably yes, probably no, no, or no information, based on the information provided by the RCT you are reading. So the first question asks, was the allocation sequence random? And this is actually the goal of conducting RCTs. Randomization means that every member in the population has equal chance to get selected and participate in the RCT. In our example, every individual undergoing total joint replacement, either total hip replacement or total knee replacement, should have equal chance to get selected. The benefit of randomization is that it gives you the best and the most representative sample of the population. The randomization guarantees that you will have a balanced prognostic factors in both groups. The prognostic factors are any baseline characteristics of the patient that might influence the patient condition after receiving the assigned intervention. In our example, if a patient with a history of venous thromboembolism, which is a prognostic factor, will undergo total hip or total knee replacement, there is a high chance that this patient will develop deep venous thrombosis or pulmonary embolism after the surgery. So randomization will take care of all these prognostic factors and balance them between the two groups. If you are 100% sure that randomization or the study did the randomization, you can answer the question by yes. If you are not 100% sure, you can answer the question by probably yes. In contrast, if you are 100% sure that randomization did not occur, you can answer the question by no. And if you are not 100% sure, you can answer by probably no. But if there is nothing mentioned by the study and you couldn't reach to an answer, you can answer the question by no information. The second question is concerned about whether the allocation sequence was concealed or not. The allocation concealment means that the physician or the study personnel who is responsible for the randomization will never know whether the next patient that will participate in the study will get randomized into the treatment group or the control group. The point of allocation concealment is to do proper randomization, because if the allocation sequence was random but not concealed, this will open a window for manipulation. For example, if the physician responsible for the randomization saw a patient who is eligible to be included in the trial, and the physician already knows that the next patient will be randomized to the treatment group, the physician may not offer this patient a chance to participate in the trial because the patient is elderly, smoker, obese, suffer from many medical comorbidities, and most likely will have complications after receiving the intervention, which shows that the new treatment is not effective. So the allocation concealment will preserve the randomization and close the window for any manipulation. The randomization is considered proper randomization, and the allocation sequence is concealed if the trial performed the randomization using computer-generated random numbers, throwing dice, coin tossing, etc. The randomization is considered improper randomization or predictable randomization, and the allocation sequence is not concealed if the trial performed the randomization using alternation method, which means that the first patient will undergo to the treatment group and the second patient will undergo to the control group, and so on. Methods based on the dates, like date of birth or date of admission, patient medical record number, etc. So you will answer this question by yes, probably yes, probably no, no or no information, based on the information provided by the RCT. The third question is concerned about whether there were substantial differences in baseline characteristics, which suggests that there is an issue with the randomization. We said that the randomization guarantees that you will have a balanced prognostic factors in both groups, such as age, gender, body mass index, smoking status, medical comorbidities, etc. So if we went back to table 1 of any trial and found substantial differences in these baseline characteristics or prognostic factors, this indicates that there is an issue with the randomization and the randomization may not be performed properly. Again, you will answer this question by yes, probably no or no information. Then you have to judge the whole domain to have low risk of bias, high risk of bias, or some concerns according to the algorithm I'm going to provided by the tool. But before we move to the algorithm, I would like to highlight the most important differences between this tool and the old one. In the old tool, we used to treat the question about the randomization and the question about the allocation concealment as two separate domains. However, the new tool combined the two questions in one domain, as both are concerned about issues that arise from the randomization, also known as selection bias, and added a third question to them, which is concerned about substantial differences in baseline characteristics. Another difference is that in the old tool, we used to judge each domain to have low risk of bias, high risk of bias, or unclear risk of bias. However, in the new tool, the phrase unclear risk of bias was changed to some concerns, as unclear risk of bias is a vague phrase and does not deliver a clear and useful meaning. So, the algorithm for the first domain starts with the second question concerned about the allocation concealment. If you answer this question by no or probably no, you will judge the domain to have higher risk of bias. But if you answer this question by no information, you have to move to the third question concerned about substantial differences in baseline characteristics between the two groups. If you answer this question by yes or probably yes, your judgment for the whole domain will be high risk of bias. But if you judge if you answer this question by no or probably no or no information, your judgment will be some concerns, and so on with the low risk of bias. In our example, the randomization was properly performed and the allocation sequence was concealed, as the randomization sequences were computer generated. Also, there were no substantial differences in baseline characteristics across the two groups, according to table 1. So my judgment for the first domain was low risk of bias. The second domain is concerned about assessing the risk of bias due to deviations from the intended intervention, also known as performance bias. The first two questions asks whether the study participants and the treating physicians are aware of the intervention to which each participant was assigned. So, ideally, we want the patients and the treating physicians to be blinded to the intervention delivered to each patient. The point of blinding the participants is to minimize the influence of the patient's behavior based on the intervention they are receiving. Because if the patients are taking a placebo and the patients are aware that they are taking placebo, some of the patients will behave as being sick or feel that their condition is getting worse, even if they actually getting better. And the point of blinding the treating physicians is to prevent them from either intentionally or unintentionally giving extra care to the treatment group and less care to the control group. In order for the trial to show excellent results with the new treatment compared to the control. The knowledge of the study participants and the treating physicians about the intervention assigned to each patient is attributed to something called performance bias. However, in some cases, like comparing a surgical intervention to a conservative management, it's not possible to blind the study participants or the treating physicians. In this situation, the knowledge of the study participants and the treating physicians about the intervention assigned to each participant is considered acceptable. The third question is a conditional question, which means that you have to answer the third question if you answered by yes, probably yes, no information to the first or the second question. Each trial has a protocol written before the inception of the trial. And the protocol contained the details regarding the course of management for the patients who are going to be assigned to the treatment group or the control group, the desired outcomes that will be assessed by the study, and the investigations or laboratory evaluations that will be performed throughout the study period. The third question is concerned about whether the knowledge of the study participants or the treating physicians about the intervention assigned to each participant led to failure in implementing the pre-specified protocol. In other words, whether the knowledge of the study participants or the treating physicians about the intervention assigned to each participant led to, for example, more visits to the clinic, more analgesics, more analgesic prescriptions, more investigations or laboratory evaluations, or more outcomes measured in either or both of the treatment and the control group that was not mentioned in the pre-specified protocol. Then you have to answer the first question. If you answer the third question by yes, probably yes, you have to answer the fourth question. The fourth question is concerned about whether the non-protocol interventions, such as more visits to the clinic, more analgesic prescriptions, more investigations or laboratory evaluations, lead to an increase or decrease in the incidence of the outcome. In our example, a non-protocol intervention, such as providing the patients in the opioid-specific patient education group with extra visits to the clinic, might lead to a decrease in their average opioid consumption more than the usual opioid consumption for patients undergoing total joint replacement. Then you have, if you answered the fourth question by yes, probably yes, or no information, you have to answer the fifth question. The fifth question is concerned about whether these non-protocol interventions were balanced between the two groups or not. In our example, if you provided the patients in the opioid-specific patient education with a non-protocol intervention such as extra visits to the clinic, you have to balance and provide the patients in the standard of care group with extra visits to the clinic similar to the opioid-specific patient education group. Then you have to move to the sixth question. The sixth question is concerned about whether the analysis model that was used is appropriate or not. Both intention to treat and modified intention to treat are considered appropriate analysis, appropriate models for the analysis, while Bayer protocol and as treated are considered inappropriate analysis model. I will mention the definition of each of these analysis models in the next slide. So in the intention to treat analysis model, the participants analyzed in the original group they were assigned to. Usually in RCTs, some patients assigned to the control group will get shifted into the treatment group for many reasons, such as the patient condition got worse and life-threatening. So the treating physician decided to give the patient the actual treatment, or the patients assigned to the treatment group sustained serious side effects of the new treatment. So the treating physician decided to shift the patient to the control group. So when the intention to treat analysis is used, all the participants who were randomized to the control group will be analyzed as a part of the control group, regardless if they receive the actual treatment or if they receive the control. And also, the participants analyzed to the treatment group will be analyzed as a part of the treatment group, regardless if they receive the placebo or the actual treatment. Intention to treat analysis is also called once randomized, always analyzed. The point of using intention to treat analysis is to preserve the randomization that we did in the beginning of the study, because we randomized for a reason, which is to equalize prognostic factors between the two groups. So we use intention to treat to preserve the whole reason of, or the whole benefit of randomization, which is trying to make the two groups in our study as similar as possible. In the modified intention to treat, the participants analyzed in the original group they were assigned to, just like the intention to treat. However, the participants will be excluded from the analysis if they had missing outcome data at baseline, which means that the patient was randomized, then disappeared for whatever reason, before even the baseline data get measured, or if the participant withdrew or died before providing any outcome data, which means that the patient took the assigned intervention but did not show at the first follow-up appointment for whatever reason. In the inappropriate analysis models, we have Bayer protocol, where the participants analyzed only if they received the assigned intervention. So Bayer protocol is completely opposite to intention to treat. In other words, any patient get randomized to the control group but receive the actual treatment instead will be excluded from the analysis. Another inappropriate analysis model is as treated, where the participants analyzed in the intervention group they received. So as treated is the middle between intention to treat and Bayer protocol. In other words, any patient randomized to the control group but receive the actual treatment will be analyzed as a part of the treatment group. Actually, I usually get confused by all these definitions, so I created my own algorithm to identify the model of analysis used by each trial, because some of the trials do not clearly state the model of analysis they used, so I need to figure it out myself. So the first question I ask myself whether all included participants in the trial were available for the analysis, meaning that there is no loss to follow up. If yes, then this is intention to treat analysis by default. If no, I will move to the second survey and ask whether all included participants received their assigned intervention. If yes, then the trial either used intention to treat or the modified intention to treat. In order to differentiate between the two, I will ask whether the participants who had missing data at baseline, withdraw or died before providing any outcome data, were included in the analysis. If yes, they were included, then this means that the trial used intention to treat analysis model. If they were excluded from the analysis, this means that the trial used the modified intention to treat for the analysis. If my answer to the question about whether all included participants received their assigned intervention was no, then I will ask, what happened to the participants who did not receive their assigned intervention? Here we have one of three options. If they were excluded from the analysis, then the trial used Bayer protocol analysis model. If they were grouped and analyzed according to the intervention they received, then the trial used as treated analysis model. If they were analyzed in the original group to which they were randomized, then the trial either used intention to treat or the modified intention to treat for the analysis. This is the algorithm for the second domain, which is pretty much similar to the first domain. If the study participants and the treating physicians were blind, the first part will be judged to have low risk of bias, and if appropriate analysis model was used, the second part will judge to have low risk of bias, and so on with the algorithm. In our example, the study participants and the treating physicians were blind, so my answer to the first and the second question was probably no, and the study used as a treated analysis model, which is considered inappropriate, so my answer to the sixth question was no. As I answered the sixth question by no, I had to answer the seventh question, which is concerned about whether using inappropriate analysis model and the number of participants who analyzed in a group other than the group they were originally randomized to or simply excluded from the analysis led to substantial impact on the results. In our example, only 5 participants out of 539 participants were randomized to a certain group and analyzed in another group, which is a very small number and most likely will not have a substantial impact on the results. So my answer was probably no, and my judgment for the second domain was some concerns. The third domain assesses the risk of bias arising from missing outcome data, also known as attrition bias. So in some RCTs, the duration of the trial is very short and none of the participants will be lost to follow-up. However, in other RCTs, the duration of the trial is very long and many participants will be lost to follow-up due to many reasons, such as the participants moved to another place, died, or simply does not want to continue in the trial. For example, there was a trial that aimed to examine the efficacy of the modified Valsalva maneuver for the termination of supraventricular tachycardia compared to the standard Valsalva maneuver. So any patients that come to the ER with supraventricular tachycardia confirmed by ECG will be consented and randomized to either the modified Valsalva maneuver or the standard Valsalva maneuver. Receive the assigned intervention, then the treating physicians measure the outcomes they want to measure, and that's it. No further follow-up or anything. The whole trial performed and finished in the ER within 1 hour for each participant. In such a context, the data will be available for almost all the participants and there will be no loss to follow up because the trial duration is very short. It's only 1 hour for each participant. In contrast, there was another trial that aimed to examine the efficacy of aspirin in reducing the risk of developing colorectal cancer in elderly patients compared to placebo. So here, the trial duration was very long, and the study participants had to take aspirin or placebo for 5 years, which is a very long period of time. And there is a high chance that many participants will be lost to follow-up because they moved to another place, died, or simply does not want to continue in the trial. So the first question is concerned about whether the data was available for all or nearly all participants randomized. If the data for a certain outcome was available for 95% of the participants, this is considered sufficient to answer this question by yes or probably yes. But of course, there is a window to override this cutoff because the answer for this question totally depends on the trial context. You have to answer the second question if you answered by no, probably no, or no information to the first question. The second question is concerned about whether the trial used any analysis model or performed a sensitivity analysis to make sure that the trial result was not affected by missing outcome data due to the lost follow-up issue. The most commonly used analysis mod or analysis methods to correct for bias arising from missing outcome data are last observation carried forward and non-responder imputation. I don't want to get into the details of these analysis models because this is not the aim of my presentation. So you have to answer the third question. If you answered by no, probably no to the second question. And the third question is concerned about whether the loss to follow-up or withdrawal from the study could be related to the participant's health status, such as the participants died or withdrew from the study because they suffered from serious side effects or cannot tolerate the treatment or intervention they were assigned to. Then you have to answer the fourth question. If you answered by yes, probably yes, or no information to the third question. And the fourth question is concerned about is it likely that the loss to follow-up or withdrawal from the study related to the participant's health status or not? This question is answered by yes or probably yes if there were documented reasons that loss to follow-up or withdrawal from the study related to the participant's health status, such as the study participants suffered from serious side effects, toxicity, cannot tolerate the treatment or the intervention they were assigned to, or if loss to follow-up was substantially higher in the treatment group than the control group, with no proper justification by the trial for this difference. This is the algorithm for the third domain, pretty much similar to the previous domains. If you answered the first question about whether the data was available for all or nearly all the participants by yes or probably yes, you will judge the domain to have lower risk of bias, and so on with the algorithm. In our example, the data was available for 539 participants out of 563 participants. So the data was available for more than 95% of the participants, and my judgment was lower risk of bias for the third domain. The fourth domain assesses the risk of bias in the measurement of the outcome, also known as detection bias. So the first question is concerned about whether the way of measuring the outcomes was inappropriate, or the outcome that was the tool that was used to assess the outcomes has demonstrated poor validity. For example, one of the RCTs about the efficacy of aspirin in reducing the risk of developing colorectal cancer, and due to the long follow-up and large number of participants, the trial was measuring the incidence of colorectal cancer by asking the study participants, do you have colorectal cancer, instead of performing colonoscopy, assuming that the study participants are doing regular colonoscopy. So such a way of measuring the outcome is inappropriate, and you cannot rely on the patients about whether they have colorectal cancer or not, because cancer is a very sensitive and unfortunate matter, and many patients will hide this information from you, even if they have colorectal cancer confirmed by colonoscopy. The second question is in the fourth domain, is concerned about whether the way of measuring the outcomes, the tool or the instrument that was used to assess the outcomes, differed between the two groups, the treatment group and the control group, or whether the treatment group had more or less follow-up visits than the control group. Then you have to answer the third question. If you answered by no, probably no, or no information to the first and the second question. And the third question is concerned about whether the physician who is measuring or assessing the outcomes was aware about the intervention to which each participant was assigned. This question is very similar to the question about blinding of the study participants and the treating physicians that we mentioned in the second domain. The knowledge of the physicians who are assessing the trial outcomes about the intervention to which each participant was assigned might influence their performance. For example, the physician might see two chest X-ray images for two different patients that have similar findings and document that the first patient who was in the control group to have pneumonia, while the second patient who was in the treatment group to have normal chest X-ray. This is because the physician knew that the second patient who was in the treatment group was taking the actual treatment, which is functional and effective. So the physician subconsciously tend to consider chest X-ray for any patient in the treatment group as normal, while the opposite happens to the control group who are taking placebo. Then you have to answer the fourth question. If you answered by yes, probably yes, or no information to the third question. And the fourth question is concerned about whether the knowledge of the physicians who are assessing the outcomes about the intervention to which each participant was assigned to could influence their judgment or measurement of the outcomes. This is only suspected if the physicians assessing the outcomes were aware about the intervention to which each participant was assigned, and the trial, the outcomes of the trial or the trial outcomes were observer reported outcomes or outcomes that are subjectively assessed, like reading radiographs, examining biopsies, measuring range of motion, etc. However, we should not suspect any influence on the outcomes if the physicians assessing the outcomes were blinded, or if the outcomes of the trial are objectively measured outcomes, such as laboratory findings, muscle strength measured by dynamometer, electrophysiological outcomes, etc. Then you have to answer the fifth question. If you answered by yes, probably yes, or no information to the fourth question. And the fifth question is concerned about whether there is a strong reason to believe that the knowledge of the physicians who are assessing the outcomes about the intervention to which each participant was assigned likely to influence their judgment or measurement of the outcome. This question is answered by yes or probably yes if the trial clearly stated this issue, or the findings of the trial substantially vary from the what has been already reported in the literature without a proper justification by the trial for this variation. This is the suggested algorithm for the fourth domain. It's pretty much similar to the previous domains. In our example, the method of measuring the outcome for all the participants, including average opioid consumption, number of opioid refills, number of patients with opioid leftover pills, and number of patients taking opioid after hospital discharge, was appropriate, and the way of measuring these outcomes did not differ between the two groups. So my answer to the first two questions was probably no. Also, the outcome assessors or the people who are assessing the outcomes were blinded to the intervention to which each participant was assigned. So my answer to the third question was no. And my judgment for the whole domain was low risk of bias. Finally, the fifth domain assesses the risk of bias in selection of the reported results, also known as reporting bias. So the first question is concerned about whether there was a pre-specified analysis plan that contains all the details for data analysis at the beginning of the trial before collecting or obtaining any data from the study participants. Usually, any RCT is required to have a pre-specified protocol registered and published in one of the trial registries, such as clinicaltrials.gov. The protocol should contain the detailed methodology of everything that's going to be done by the trial, especially the analysis plan, and the goal of having everything pre-specified is to close the window for manipulation, such as reporting results for certain outcomes and hiding others. Then the second and the third questions are concerned about whether the trial measured a certain outcome multiple times or using different scales or definitions, or perform the analysis multiple times using different analysis models, then they only reported the significant results. For example, a trial measured the pain after receiving the intervention by asking the patients to grade their pain using a 10-point pain scale, and also by grading their pain as mild, moderate, or severe pain. The trial also asked the patients to grade their pain in the first 30 minutes after the intervention and the first 60 minutes after the intervention. Then in the analysis, the trial analyzed the data using intention to treat and bare protocol analysis models. So pain outcome was reported using two different scales at two different time points and analyzed using two different analysis models. Eventually, the trial only reported the results of pain in the first 60 minutes after the intervention using the 10-point pain scale and using the bare protocol analysis model because it was the only findings that had p-value less than 0.05, which means that it is significant findings. And this is what we mean by reporting bias. We can figure out reporting bias by comparing what was written in the pre-specified protocol about the way of measuring the outcomes and the plan for data analysis with what was actually done by the trial. If there was substantial difference, or if there was a substantial difference between what was planned to be done and what was actually done without a proper justification by the trial, then this means that the trial most likely have reporting bias. In our example, the study participants or the trial itself had a pre-specified protocol registered in clinicaltrials.gov, which contained a detailed analysis plan. Also, the trial did not perform the or measurement of the outcome multiple times or perform the analysis multiple times. So the my judgment for the fifth domain was low risk of bias. Then the overall risk of bias in the revised Cochrane risk of bias assessment tool provided us with a chance to give an overall low risk of bias for each trial, which is something that we did not use to do in the old tool. We judge the trial to have an overall low risk of bias if all the five domains had low risk of bias. However, if one domain had high risk of bias, then the overall judgment will be high risk of bias. Similarly, if one of the five domains had some concerns, the overall judgment will be some concerns. And if three or more of the five domains had some concerns, the overall judgment will become high risk of bias. In our example, the overall judgment was some concerns because the trial had some concerns in the second domain. So overall, the trial provided a strong evidence and had robust methodology, but their only methodological issue was that they used as treated analysis model instead of intention to treat or modified intention to treat. These are my references. This is the example, the trial example I used. And this is the old Cochrane risk of bias assessment tool. This is the reference for the revised Cochrane risk of bias assessment tool. This concludes my presentation. If you have any questions or concerns, don't hesitate to contact me directly on Twitter or through my email. And thank you for listening.